Hello, everyone. Welcome to season two of Mom at Home. It's hard to believe that season one only started a couple months ago, but after 25 episodes, we decided we needed to think about the future of Mom at Home, where we're going, what we're doing, how we're going to get there. And we sent out a couple of surveys to our homepage, to all of our supporters and friends, and the feedback was phenomenal. We appreciate everyone letting us know what was up and you wanted to see and how we were going to do it. So, as you can see, I'm back at home. I'm still at home here in my studio in Temecula, California. I've made a few changes, maybe upgraded my camera a little bit, got some lighting so you can see all the face. So hopefully it doesn't startle you too much to see all, you know, the wrinkles and details of my face now. But other than that, we're very happy to be kicking off season two. We have a very special guest today, exploring a topic which is interesting to me, because as a drummer, it is our job to work with the low end. Anybody who takes care of bass, we are good friends with. And today we have our very own Dr. Jonathan Piper, who is a tuba player, but also Scott Sutherland, who is a fellow low brass enthusiast, tuba player, educator, musician. I'm actually going to turn it over to Jonathan to give you the formal.
Well, thanks, BJ. The number one response overwhelmingly on the surveys was tuba content. So we are really delighted to launch season two with some prime tuba content. As BJ mentioned, we are joined today by really great guest, Scott Sutherland, local tubist. You live like 5 minutes from the museum.
I do.
Yeah, which is pretty incredible. You've given a presentation for our volunteers before for the low power and beauty of bass exhibition a few years ago. You play all over Southern California, and you were just telling a story about traveling around the country with a brass quintet. Also, you and I happened to go to school together for a year, I think, right? That was you.
I think we overlapped. Yeah, just a little bit.
Yeah.
But I was a graduate student, so I didn't like to talk to you because you were a lowly freshman and I just don't associate, you know, as the upper echelon of students at UCLA at that point.
I don't blame you. so it's great to, you know, live in the same region as you. I'm down in my garage in San Diego. So we're regionally separate, you know, geographically separated a little bit, but we do definitely live in the same region. And it's really fantastic to be so close to a fellow tubist and just all around good person. So thank you.
We don't hang out enough, clearly, if you think I'm a good person. That's
sorry, you know. I switched over to next week's script. Halfway through the sentence there, but so it's really great to have you, Scott, and really excited to talk to you today about all things tuba.
I am thrilled to be here. That presentation I did for the volunteers was just, it was so much fun interacting with those volunteers and those in the audience, and just being able to kind of showcase a little bit about what I do, because generally speaking, if I meet up with some of my neighbors, they have zero idea what I do for a living. All they hear is, you know, from emanating from the garage. And so this is a wonderful way just to kind of, you know, be an ambassador, musical ambassador for my instrument and for musicians in general. So looking forward to this.
Yeah. So to kind of start from the beginning, maybe literally, so, you know, as the Museum of Making Music, we are very interested in instruments and where instruments come from. And I'm hoping that we can maybe just chat a little bit about where the tuba comes from. What is a tuba? Why the tuba? Why did anybody think to make such an unwieldy instrument? What are your thoughts? Maybe take us back to 1835.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. So, you know, something really, really important happened. It was 1832, I believe, was the invention of the piston valve, or it was a version of a valve, which is a switch on our instruments that allows the air to travel into different tubes, lengthening the tube, therefore, and allowing us to not just get the harmonic series, just get a limited number of notes, but actually get the notes in between the notes and be able to play the entire spectrum of pitches that would be available to us. And that invention of the valve, as soon as that was trademarked, it it spread like wildfire around Europe, inventing, allowing people to invent new and exciting instruments that allowed us to, expand the number of instruments that were in the orchestra, and allow composers to kind of explore new sounds. This is the very beginning of the Romantic period, which was an era after Mozart and Beethoven, where we started getting really, really excited about doing big dramatic works, works that really tell a story. And one way that we can do that is by having new colors and new sounds. And so, so shortly after the invention of the valve, one thing that was kind of lacking was a bass instrument for the brass family. We had a version of the trombone for a while that was used by a little bit by Mozart and certainly by Beethoven. And we certainly had trumpets. We certainly had French horns. So we had kind of the sopranos with the trumpets. We had the alto family with the French horns. We had the tenors. And we were missing a bass voice in the brass section. So musical instrument manufacturers and these inventors were scrambling to find what would work best. And they very quickly realized it's kind of hard to make one that works. And it took a while. It took a while to figure it out. We had all sorts of weird instruments that sort of looked like you go to any musical instrument museum, that showcases these kinds of instruments. You know, there's one like in Brussels and one in Arizona, and they'll have these like really ancient, weird looking instruments. One that's called the serpent. One that's called an awful Clyde. I like to call it an awful Clyde because it doesn't play in tune and it sounds terrible. And once the tuba was invented, we finally like kind of landed on something that really worked. And it was a beautiful, beautiful moment. The heavens opened up, angels were singing. It was truly, a Hallmark moment at that point. So,
So then,
wow, I didn't know I could pull that out of
just call it right there. So we have a tuba in the mid 1830s. We have a tuba now. What have we done in the last almost 200 years now? How have tubas changed? What kind of new developments have there been? Would somebody from the 1830s recognize a modern tuba as something from the same family?
Well, it's really interesting. Tubas, maybe because of I'd be totally speculating why, but for whatever reason, when you see a trumpet, all trumpets sort of kind of look the same, you know? I mean, there's generally a design that kind of, it's like, that's the trumpet, and maybe they'll do little tweaks here and there with sizes of, the tubing and everything else, but trumpet looks like a trumpet. The tuba, there's lots of different kinds of looking tubas, and people are still experimenting with different tuba designs. We still haven't like kind of landed on a, singular tuba design. I mean, trombones, they've looked the same for hundreds of years, and for whatever reason, French horn players, they still use their left hand to operate the valves of the French horn. They haven't done anything to that in literally hundreds of years. So for us, it's a little different. Lots of different things. We have experiments with different types of valve systems, from the rotary valves that twist and turn just like French horn valves, to the piston valves, the one that go up and down just like on trumpets. And we have lots of different shapes and sizes. There was a time during the 1960s and 70s where it was really popular to kind of have a little bit more of a compact tuba. And now the big thing is bigger is better. And everyone has these huge, huge, monstrous tubas to play in orchestras and such. And it just kind of is the thing to do now. So we have all of these, and we have them in all different keys because, largely you know, people had different instruments that they were writing for. Different composers were writing in different ways. And so some of them wrote really high tuba parts and some of them wrote really low tuba parts and everything in between. So we have to have an arsenal of different kinds of tubas to kind of get the job done. So, you know, they all just kind of look different. And, you know, I have a few here that I can show you.
Could you please show us?
Are you pretty please?
Pretty please, Scott. A cherry on top. With a cherry on top.
Well, speaking to that, those really large instruments. All right, mm-hmm. that's the first one I got here. Is the Big Daddy.
Fantastic.
Oh, and it's shiny too. All right.
Yeah.
So this is that's my bell.
Okay.
And these are piston valves, the ones that go up and down.
Mm-hmm.
And
how many Scots could we fit in that bell? as a
well, you mean post quarantine or pre quarantine? Because that definitely makes a difference in terms of size. The COVID-19 is a real thing, but yeah, it's quite large. This one is on the lighter side. This one weighs about 25 pounds, mm-hmm. but there are definitely tubas out there that can weigh 35, 40 pounds, just, you know, depending on the size of the thickness of the metal and what kind of metal it's really, you know, comprised of and, mm-hmm. and everything else. But here's what this one sounds like. So it has a really nice range. It's you know, I don't know what it kind of sounds like over you know, YouTube here, but you know, it has a nice big pillowy wonderful sound that is really great at kind of putting the bottom end to an orchestra or mm-hmm. a concert band. So
right, and so if you had to use a more specific description than a big tuba, what sorts of words would you as a tubist use to describe
as this? A tubist, we use this nomenclature, we use these 6/4 and 4/4 and 5/4 and 3/4. There is no 2/4. There's no half size that I am aware of. There is no 1/4. It sort of borrows from, you know, the string family, you know, mm-hmm. the string family. When kids are starting out, they have, you know, a 1/8 size or 1/4 size or 3/4 size violin, you know, depending on the age of the child and the, you know, and their fingers and, you know, length of their arms and all of those kinds of things. And so it kind of borrows from that, but not really. And we're just trying to keep up with the cool kids. And so this is the largest. There is no 7/4. This is the 6/4. You know, it's 1.5 times the size of a normal tuba. But what's a normal tuba? This is what we were just kind of talking about.
Right,
it's like,
right.
What is a normal size? What's a 4/4 size instrument? What is a 1 tuba? 1 tuba? You see, it's just confusing, you know, and we're just tuba players.
Don't go down that road. Don't go down that road.
That's normally what we play. So we're pretty simple folks. You know, we can't really handle the maths, you know, too much there. So
so jokes aside, so you mentioned that we have all different kinds of keys.
Yeah.
Some people out there who are familiar with other, you know, the high brass trumpet especially might know that there's a B flat trumpet and a C trumpet.
I see yeah.
What key is this in and what does that mean? And it means something, right? A little bit different for a tubist than for a trumpeter, right?
Right. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So so this is pitched in C, meaning that when I play the lowest note possible without pressing any of the valves, a C will come out. Or. And that low note that you just heard, that's the first C at the left end of the piano. All right. Mm-hmm. It's the first one you come to. You know, the third white key on any piano would be that particular note. You know, just you know, little side note here, the tuba is actually the instrument that can play lower than any other instrument in the orchestra, meaning, you know, a contrabassoon can hit the B flat below that. That's the lowest note that a contrabassoon can play. Mm-hmm. That A is what a piano can play. And you can just keep on going down. So we beat you all. So sorry, bassoonists. Sorry, pianists. Sorry, all you sorry people. We're better than you. So is that rude? Is that did I just lose some of the audience? Did our numbers just go down? I'm sorry.
That was the technically accurate answer, though. So
so this is pitched in C. So the what's called the fundamental is C. And just like if you were to, you know, stretch a string out and touch your finger lightly in the middle and then pluck one side or the other, it actually divides in half and the next octave comes out. Mm-hmm. And then if you divide that string into threes, you actually get above that. So these are all called harmonics, all right? It's all Pythagorean theorem. It's all math, actually. And it's what happens. It's all of these notes that can be produced by just a tube, a singular tube without the valves going. So you know, we can just keep going up, and you could probably hear that the notes got a lot closer together as you went up. Okay, so but.
Scott, quick question for you, buddy. We have one of our museum staff watching, Mr. Bill, and he loves the puns. So he says, "Keep them coming." Those are wonderful. We love it. But he also, right after you belted out those low notes, he wanted to know kind of what context would you be playing those low notes.
Well, actually, the last time I played with a really big orchestra. Was back in January. John Adams, famous composer, was actually at the podium conducting his pieces, and mm-hmm. I was playing second tuba. I mean, normally you only have one tuba in an orchestra, but this particular time I was playing second tuba, and my gosh, that note was all over the place. He loves playing those low notes. So all of those notes are definitely in a standard range for certain composers. I got to go on tour with an orchestra, the one piece I was playing was, again, second tuba on Varese, Amarique. And it's another one of these pieces where you're just playing as loud as humanly possible on really, really low notes, and it's a lot of fun. it's a lot of fun, especially when you're in like Paris and the people are going wild for their hometown composer. Uh-huh. And you're just belting it out in their, you know, their amazing concert hall. So those notes are definitely in the wheelhouse. Varese actually wrote a piece that went down to that G, which is actually below, I'm forgetting. Do you know the piece? I'm forgetting what piece it is, but it's towards the end of the piece, and mm-hmm. and it's a G, and it's absolute. It's almost solo. The entire orchestra just drops out, and all you hear is, you know, in the back of the orchestra hall. It's awesome, awesome. This is what we live for, all right? We have to sit around for 30 minutes waiting to actually play. And then when we play, it's glory. Pure glory. So,
yes. Well, okay, let's say that we weren't all giant weirdos and we wanted to play something a little bit more melodic or lighter.
Okay. All right. I see where you're going with this.
Yeah, so you're talking about a tuba that seems to exist primarily to get those big low notes for the John Adamses and the Edgar Vareses of the world.
Yeah.
What if you had, let's say, one of those English composers who likes a slightly lighter sound, like, for example, a Ralph Vaughan Williams. Is there a different instrument that you might use for a context that asks for something a little airier?
BJ, he's good. Just, I, transitions are like spot on. Yes. In fact, Mr. Jonathan Piper, Dr. Jonathan Piper, excuse me. I'm a mister. You're a doctor. There is an instrument for that. Such a purpose. This is an F tuba. So it's pitched, you know, four notes above that other instrument that we were just hearing. And this particular instrument, you know, with my wide angle lens, it actually ends up looking like the same size as the previous instrument. But truth be told, this is quite a bit smaller than the instrument you saw before. And it has these rotary valves. If you can see, as soon as I press this valve, it's twisting and rotating the valve inside the casing there. So there's your Vaughn Williams for the day. All right.
Thank you. That's enough.
So you can play a lot higher, a lot more melodic. I just did a YouTube video of entirely on this instrument, just solo, and I played the piano part to the Billie Eilish tune "No Time to Die" for the new Bond film, and you know,
I think we've actually got a clip of that.
Well, yeah, because I haven't filmed it, so if you have a clip of it, I really want to know where you got it, because that's really impressive.
Again, I was reading the script for next week's episode.
That's right. I don't know. That makes a lot of sense. No, so I'm able to play something a lot more lyrical and more soloistic, you know. That sort of thing. So that's from that particular pop tune. So and this just has a nice ringing singing quality, and we would definitely use it for you know, English music or some French music would definitely lend itself to this particular instrument. Or sometimes for playing music that was written for an instrument that came before the tuba, that maybe was written in a higher tessitura, you know. You know, very famously, Hector Berlioz wrote a piece called Symphonie Fantastique, which originally used that awful Clyde instrument, which had, you know, multiple keys. It looked more like a saxophone than it did a tuba, but it had a mouthpiece more like a trombone, and it was
really awful intonation.
Really terrible. And so he actually wrote for two different keyed instruments, knowing full well that one instrument will have pretty good notes and the other instrument will have different good notes. And between the two of them, hopefully you get at least one good instrument together. So, you know, but there's this section in the middle of the Symphonie Fantastique where it's this old Gregorian chant, the Dies Irae, all right? And it was trying to sound as just kind of demonic as possible. So, and you actually, that particular tune, the first use is used everywhere. I mean, you can hear that in almost any John Williams tune, you know, or John Williams movie. You know, at some point you're going to hear that. You're going to hear it at the very beginning of The Shining, for instance, you know, and lots of different places. So it's, but this is that instrument that that was really good for kind of bringing that character about.
Fantastic.
Hey, Scott, I had a couple other questions from the audience coming in.
Oh, yes.
And yeah, there you go. So I realize that as they're watching, my audio and video are out of sync, so I'm trying to fix that on the fly, but don't worry about that.
I am
right
so
now.
Disturbed by that, just so you know.
I know.
Greatly disturbed.
Let's see. Win question is from Marina. How can a tuba player control the air before blowing their eyes out and more? So, like, there's a lot of air coming out. I assume at some point the eyes are just going to come flying out of your head. How do you guys control for your...
Well, the reason why there's only one tuba player in the orchestra is that all of the other ones that tried out came to an untimely end from blowing their... head? No. no, you know, there is quite a lot of air, but believe it or not, actually, there's a couple of instruments that actually technically use more air than the tuba. The bass trombone, the flow rate of the bass trombone is actually higher than the tuba, and flute. Flute actually uses just use a little tiny stream, but it has to move so fast that that they are using quite a lot of air as well. So they actually are in much more danger of popping their eyes out, I think, than we are, because our air actually has a huge volume of air, but it has to move very, very slowly. So we're not under a lot of pressure like you would see like a trumpet player like trying to play really, really high. They're using a lot of pressure and squeezing, you know, more so than we are. We're actually more focused on trying to be as relaxed as we can. So our eyes are in a complete and total safety. No worries about that. It is a lot of air, and we definitely do a lot of exercises for breathing and everything else. But it's just a huge column of air that is moving very, very slowly and as relaxed as possible.
That's comforting. That's comforting to know. So,
for my children's sake, also, it is really a wonderful thing.
Also, do you know why the tuba is called a tuba?
Actually, I don't. Dr. Piper, you are more academically inclined than I am. Do you have any idea why it is called a tuba? I'm assuming it's just tube. Like
it's the Latin for trumpet.
Okay.
So the brass, the natural horns that would have been used in Roman Empire were called tubas. And if you look at old Latin texts, they will have the word tuba in them, and that's referring to the trumpet. Now, I'm not at all certain why, again, I have to do a refresher, but I'm not remembering why people who made trumpets didn't call them tubas, and why that word was still, you know, not trademarked by the 1830s when somebody made what they then called a tuba. But for example, the piece of information I do have access to, there's a great Coggle piece written for tuba, a contemporary composer, and you have to recite some text, some biblical text in Latin. And part of that text is coming from I think Revelations, and it's about tuba mirum, spargens sonum, the trumpet makes a strange sound, but because it's the word tuba, he then turns it into a tuba piece. So tuba from the Latin, yeah, tuba from the Latin, but now we're a couple of octaves off through some sort of historical process.
Well, you know, just so you know, I was actually just kind of allowing you to answer that question. I fully knew that answer. And actually, I know I can go a step further. And my understanding is that no one... they were reserving that particular word for the pinnacle of tubes and the absolute pinnacle of musical execution. And so they came across a lot of different brass instruments and just like, no, it's just not good enough.
Yeah.
And then they saw the tuba and they're like, yes, that's it.
When somebody makes a Wikipedia article out of this, there's going to be the citation needed bracket next to that one.
My apologies to Nam.
So BJ, I've got a good follow-up there if we don't have any more audience questions at the moment.
We do, but we can get to those. No worries.
So I want to get back to this idea of a tube. Because the tuba is basically just one long tube, right, from the mouthpiece to the end of the bell. And kind of like you were mentioning, did my video just freeze?
Yeah. Yes, it did.
Okay. Let me see if that helps at all.
I can't see you.
There we go. I'm back. So you mentioned that tubas have all sorts of different shapes and sizes. Are there any other brass instruments that use maybe the same amount of tubing, but in just a very different shape?
No.
Okay.
So, I mean, that was a really good setup, but no, this is a dead end. Oh, wait a second. I can think of one.
Oh, what is it?
So, this is actually an instrument that I use down at the San Diego Zoo with the Chameleons Brass Band. And I'll be right back. Can you give me 30 seconds?
Sure.
I need to do a bit of a change here.
Okay.
This is exciting. Drum roll, maybe, BJ.
No. So maybe we'll talk amongst ourselves.
Yeah, maybe. I'll fill in a little bit of the historical context here. So for those who've been watching, Scott, oh man, you already gave it away. So as we're seeing, right, Scott, you can walk with that instrument.
I can walk. I can talk.
Could you have walked and talked with some of those other instruments? I mean, could you imagine carrying your 6-quarter C and trying to carry on a conversation?
Yeah, I've seen people try. And it's hilarious.
So people try, and they don't do it so well. But let's say you are, living in the, right around the turn of the century, and you happen to run a professional marching band, and the quality of your band depends on somebody being able to play the notes of the tuba, but being able to walk, potentially carry on a conversation at some point. What is this thing that you have that was invented for that purpose?
Well, yeah, sousaphone. This is actually the amount of tubing here is actually 2 feet longer than my C tuba, my big C tuba. So we didn't kind of detail that out, but if you stretch the tuba out without the valves, if you just stretched the pipe that goes from the mouthpiece all the way to the bell, it'd be about 16 feet for a C tuba. This instrument is actually pitched one full step lower than the C tuba. This is a B flat sousaphone. So my opening note, whereas it was a C before, now it's a B flat. So that is then the black note at the very left end of the piano, is that B flat. So this is an instrument that was developed for marching bands, especially for military bands. It's named after John March, composer and the great band leader, especially of the President's Own and the other military bands. And this has been then adopted into jazz. And you'll see this a lot in New Orleans, playing Dixieland band. I like playing lots of different things. You can play, that sort of thing. You can play certainly, marches. And all of these things are synonymous with this particular instrument. You'll see marching bands and you'll see Dixieland bands. And if you go to the San Diego Zoo over the summer, not this summer, hopefully next summer,
hopefully
you'll see this this instrument used in the Chameleons Brass Band. So
fantastic. So would a sousaphone ever get used in a symphony orchestra?
I hope not. No. It's a couple of things. First of all, the acoustical environment that is created when you have to wrap this around your body, it changes things. It changes the sound, especially because the bell is pointed forward. It is really geared for playing outside. All right. So it's a very direct sound, just like your trumpets and your trombones, which we have already determined sound terrible. We just have a drummer on here. We're okay. We're safe here.
Yeah, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it.
No.
Safe space.
Yeah. So the bell forward creates a much more direct sound, and just like the French horn, which points actually backwards, it uses a reflective environment in order to produce its best sound. And the tuba pointing up, again, uses that kind of reflective context to produce its best sound. The sousaphone going straight forward is a much more direct. It's a brighter sound. It tends to just be a little less pillowy and beautiful and a little bit more aggressive sounding, which is great in certain contexts. And especially outside, it's the only way you're going to really hear the fronts of the note, hear the body of the notes, is by hearing the sound much more direct, because the sound will be totally lost if you have to, you know, play straight up, just like, you know, the concert tuba. And then, you know, by wrapping around, it's going to, you know, be much more conducive to walking around and marching and such. So,
right. So if you can get, you know, different tone qualities, different colors from these different instruments, are there other instruments in the brass family that somebody like you might play, or that somebody might get, you know, kind of the same note, but maybe just a different tone quality?
Well, yeah. I mean, you have a lot of different instruments that you can choose from. Again, in like the 1800s, they were still experimenting and people hadn't quite landed on this is the instrument for the bottom of the orchestra. Verdi and Puccini, these Italian opera composers, famously hated the tuba sound and wanted more of a trombone sound. And so there's this instrument that was created that is sort of a big trombone with valves. It's kind of this hybrid tuba and trombone instrument. It's called the cimbasso. And it kind of fell out of favor for almost 100 years. And then my teacher, your teacher, Jonathan, Tommy Johnson, famously like walked into an old brass repair shop, instruments, a cimbasso, and he's like, I think I can use those in the Hollywood studios. And because famously, if you bring in another instrument and the composer uses both instruments, you get what's called a double and you get more money. And so Tommy was always looking for, how do I maximize my return here? And so he was always bringing in these instruments, and the film composers loved it, absolutely loved it. And so since then, since about the 90s, these cimbassos, or cimbassi, if you want to be a little bit more technical, became really, really standardized, especially in film scores and in the opera orchestras. And I have used it to, I think, great effect, you know, as a different tone color. The size. Whereas my instrument is, mine is a conical instrument where it's slowly getting bigger and bigger, and French horns are made. Made that sound where it's a different kind of sound.
And I was very disappointed to hear that you don't currently have your cimbasso, but I think we have a clip of you playing the cimbasso. I'm wondering, BJ, if we could cue that up.
Yeah, I'm seeing I might have a bit of network problems. Let me make sure that we're still okay.
He's really concentrated on this, I think.
I'm really concentrating on this right now. Well, no, I watched my network feed crater, and now my... There we
Temecula is back to work at home.
Right. It still says... Okay, I think it's okay. It still says streaming. But yes, I'm happy to pop up, and there we go. Okay, I know that active. So yes,
we have a couple of different options.
Which would you like to explore today?
Well, you know, probably the showcase that's a little bit more fun. Maybe not quite the sound we're going for, but just kind of a fun, you know, close up of it is the that You've Got a Friend in Me. That might be a good intro to this. For those who don't know, I actually have a moderately successful YouTube channel that I've created where I film myself playing multiple parts. And so I've created an ensemble of just me, performing various film, or pop tunes or video game music. And this is one that is on that particular channel. This is that theme song from Toy Story, written for four Chimbassi. There you go.
Here we go.
Let's let it go. Let it go for just a little bit longer. All right. Well, the groove is kind of lost. you get the idea that it's it's got a little bit more of a whack 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 kind of sound. And that I've kind of showcase that also is I did a video for the theme to Jaws, which also features a number of Chimbassi in a way to just kind of get those stabs in the music, which is just so wonderful. And and that particular theme is low. Okay, that's not meant to be played on the sousaphone, but but that melody at the very end of the movie is just played by a tuba, like really high up tuba. And it's supposed to be this menacing sound. And our team at UCLA, Tommy Johnson was the one who famously recorded that particular solo. So, I loved particular video just because it was a bit of an homage to our teacher. So,
yeah, you think we could cue that up for a minute or two?
Yeah. The very beginning of the... I'm strumming the strings inside my piano, and it's hard. It's kind of cool. Okay. All right, that's all right. You know something? Everyone just needs to... Oh, here we go. I'm scared already. There's that solo. You hear those Chimbassi. Well, the shark's really coming in fast. All right, this is pretty good. When the shark just like lurches forward like that, I mean that is. That is scoring,
I think that's Sharknado at that point. All right. I think we got it.
We got the idea. all of you watching, you guys can all subscribe to my channel and watch every video 16 times. Because I am on the cusp of 2 million channel views. And I fully expect this particular Scott Sutherland music. So I expect this particular, event to push me over the edge to 2 million shortly. Okay. Otherwise, I will be cursing the name of BJ and Jonathan.
I just want to touch along that point before we open it up again to visitor questions, to viewer questions. You know, as with, you know, basically every musician in the world right now, you've been affected by shelter in place orders, you know, lots of gigs just not being there. And I think you've recently done a project, really cool project, that brought together a lot of other tubists, because there are more than just us, who might have been in that same situation, you know, who might have been, you know, happened to be in their home studios ready to record something.
Yeah. I did this project. This is, famous tuba player, of course, household name, Roger Bobo, household of tuba families. He was the first tuba player to ever perform a solo recital in Carnegie Hall, believe it or not. Los Angeles Philharmonic tuba player for 25 years and soloist around the world. He now lives in Oaxaca, of all places, and we are in close contact, and we were talking, and he was really mesmerized by these videos that Eric Whitaker, composer and choral conductor,
right,
what he did with these virtual choirs like 10 years ago on YouTube. 2,000 singers from all around the world, and he wanted to do that with the tuba euphonium community, and he came to me and he asked if I could, you know, maybe come up with something. So I arranged a tuba euphonium. Euphonium is like a small tuba. It's kind of in the trombone range, and so it helps.
We can imagine what it looks like.
Yeah. You know, it's the tuba that, you know, was stuck in the dryer too long. It's very popular in military bands. You see a lot of the world's greatest euphonium players in military bands. And so, I arranged this piece by, Edward Elgar, from his Enigma Variations, an orchestra piece. And I arranged it for tubas and euphoniums and contacted 100 of the best tubas and euphoniums from all around the world. We had 24 different countries represented, all 6 continents. It was a massive, massive project getting all of these videos in. Some were just done on iPhones. Some people actually had home recording studios, but especially having Roger involved, it was something that everyone really, really wanted to do. And it's out there. It's the latest video on my channel that I just released about a week ago. And it's really been a wonderful way to kind of bring our community closer together at a time when, you know, more than ever, we feel very isolated. You know, tubas are, and euphoniums, we have this tendency to kind of be the only one of us in a group. And so us getting together is a really momentous occasion. And for us to all come together to create something musical is just a treat. So, yeah. So that is something that I would encourage everyone to check out. So,
are you ready to see the video?
Yeah. Well, we can just see just a bit of it, and then get to some of those questions. I'm gonna put this thing down. So you're seeing people from University of Alabama, the Philadelphia Orchestra, Pittsburgh Orchestra, Pittsburgh Symphony, a couple of local Los Angeles folks. Tim Higgins is the principal trombone player of the San Francisco Symphony. So it's really just all around the world. Yeah, Misa Mead is a world famous soloist out of Japan. Øystein Bodzovic is probably the premier soloist performing in orchestras as a soloist around the world.
Well, yeah, this is really beautiful. I strongly encourage all of our viewers to go check this out. I want to make sure that we do have a few minutes, because I think we've got a couple more questions.
Yeah.
Just want to make sure we have enough time to cover those.
Yeah, that's remarkable. We do have a couple questions. Let me go ahead and see what those are. Oh, here's one from Joe. I always love Joe's questions.
Yeah, me too.
Joe Rogers asks,
awesome.
Is the tuba ever played in heavy music?
Heavy metal music. Not that I know of. Like, who in the world would ever think to do that? Except maybe Dr. Piper. He's the only one crazy enough to actually attempt such a feat, right?
Yeah, well, there are a couple of us. Not quite dozens, but there are a couple of us. I play tuba through a lot of effects pedals. I know that there's a wonderful pun there, the heavy metal. But there's also a gentleman named Dan Peck in the New York area who plays as a doom metal tubist. He has a couple of solo albums where he's doing sort of tuba music in the doom aesthetic, you know, really slow and low. But then he also has a band where he plays the tuba in a doom metal context. So there are people who like to live out the pun, but for the most part, it's just a pun.
Yeah, and Dan, like, is the tuba player in the New York City Ballet. I mean,
it's amazing.
You know, he's playing Nutcracker, and then at night, you know, he'd play a matinee of the Nutcracker, and then go and do his doom metal later on that night. It's pretty incredible.
We're pretty eclectic.
We had a question from Brian, which I'm curious. I hadn't realized this. Are there left-handed and or right-handed tubas?
Well, generally speaking, 99% of them are all right-handed, just like all of the brass instruments other than French horn. They're all right-handed instruments. Just like left-hand guitars, there are the, anomalies out there. I've seen maybe two in my life. I've seen a couple of left-handed players. There's a wonderful one, plays in the Disneyland band, for many, many years, Charlie Warren, who, he would bring his left arm around the instrument and actually kind of bring his hand over the valves in such a way that he could actually play the valves left-handed. So not very common, no. But I have seen, like I said, about two in my life actually left-handed instruments. So if you have millions of dollars, right, you too can have a left-handed tuba.
That's how rare they are. Also, last question that I see here from Marina. It is the bass trombone more dynamic than the tuba to get lows and high notes?
More, well, we generally have, I would say that in general, in terms of just, what most composers use us as, we overlap a lot, though we are generally placed a little lower than the bass trombone. You have in a lot of film music, you have what's called a contrabass trombone that just a lot of times ends up playing the same notes as the tubas. But generally speaking, the bass trombone plays a little higher than the tuba, though most of our range overlaps. Is that fair to say, Dr. Piper?
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that.
Well, fantastic. I think that does it for our time today. I want to thank Scott, and I want to thank Jonathan for being part of this program, bringing back, opening up season two for Mom at Home. I had a wonderful time. I learned a lot about the tuba, and I learned about not crossing tubists. Otherwise, you'll get made fun of relentlessly. As a drummer, I already saw that happening. So I appreciate that, gentlemen, and a glimpse into your motives. That was wonderful. But definitely, I think I had a great time learning your craft about your instrument. It was a lot of fun. And Scott, one more time, what was your website where the folks can see all these great videos that we were able to sample today?
ScottSutherlandMusic.com. And then you can find me at Scott Sutherland Music in Instagram and Facebook and YouTube and all sorts of manner of various social medias. But Sutherland Music, there's no O. No O in Sutherland. All right? Cut that out. S-U-T-H-E-R-L-A-N-D.
No O in Sutherland.
There you go. Just like Kiefer, just like Donald. All right.
And you can find the Museum of Making Music at museumofmakingmusic.org. We will be back with Mom at Home on Friday. We're going to be talking, we're going to still stay in the low register. We're going to be talking about the electric bass with our very own Michael Kennedy, San Diego bassist. You can find us at museumofmakingmusic.org. You'll see the next episodes coming up at 2 p.m. Pacific time. Until then, thank you for watching and take care. Have a great day.
Thanks for checking.